Welcome to the Red Sneaker Podcast, your guide to success in the worlds of writing and publishing. Now, here's your host, best-selling author and founder of the Red Sneaker Writers Center, William Bernhardt.
Hello, Red Sneaker Writers. This is episode 12, going out on February 11, 2019. This podcast is for Red Sneaker Writers, people who are serious about building and maintaining a writing career and want practical knowledge and advice to help them do it. For this episode, I interviewed Shawn Coyne, the creator of the Story Grid, a structure or checklist you can use when writing to make sure your work contains all the essential elements that will make it a success. In this episode, I'm also debuting a new feature, writing tips that you can apply to your own creative work. But first, the news. If there is an overarching theme to this episode's news items, it is the enormous range of opportunities there are for writers in the world today, even from very non-traditional sources. First item, this just in. Steven Spielberg, probably the world's most famous director, through his company, Emblem Partners, has picked up the movie rights to The Spire in the Woods, a scary story penned by author Tony Lunidi. You might be asking, what is this? I don't remember seeing this at Barnes & Noble, and that's because it's never been there. Where has it been? On Reddit. Yes, Reddit. It was a 10-part Reddit saga back in 2013 that somebody thought could make a fabulous movie. Yes, Reddit. That app young people are constantly staring at whenever they're bored with whatever is actually going on around them. If you're a parent, that means your kids are probably staring at it pretty much any time they're with you. And you thought they were just reading news items and movie reviews, but guess what? There's fiction up there, just like Wattpad, a source of fiction I talked about on a previous podcast. Well, it's on Reddit as well. And this project is going to be developed as a movie project for Steven Spielberg. The Spire in the Woods is going to be retitled The Bells. Apparently, it's about a teenager investigating the mysterious, strange, and maybe supernatural death of someone they knew. Now, here's what's interesting to me about this. You know, just to listen to the title, either of the titles, or the plot description, it doesn't sound that different from things that you have probably read in the past. And yet, someone somewhere found this, brought it to the attention of Amblin, and said, hey, why don't we develop this as a motion picture? Even though it's never appeared in book print, book form, never appeared in a bookstore, but nonetheless, it came to the attention of the world's foremost director. And also, the co-producers on this are Vertigo Entertainment, which have developed movies like Aquaman, which just hit the billion-dollar mark. My point here is that there are alternatives to traditional publishing that are still capable of getting books in front of important people. Did I mention Wattpad? You remember Wattpad and the previous podcast when I talked about all the books from Wattpad that were being made into movies and TV shows and were apparently launching contracts with traditional publishing? Well, turns out Wattpad authors don't have to go to traditional publishing anymore because Wattpad is launching its own book publishing division called Wattpad Books. In the past, they've been working with other partners, including publishing partners, to expand the reach of Wattpad work. Well, now they're creating its own publishing division to take advantage of the huge number of people posting work on Wattpad and the even huger number of people reading it. They're going to debut with 6 titles this fall. They've already announced the titles, and the general manager there, Ashley Gardner, seems very serious about developing this into a major publishing house. In fact, they've already sold foreign rights on a couple of the books, which, of course, aren't going to be published until the fall. One big advantage that Wattpad Books has is what's called content surfacing technology, which basically means that they have the ability to search through all that fiction and some nonfiction that people have been posting on Wattpad to find exactly what their partners want. If they're working with a French publisher, and right now in France, there's a big craze for supernatural suspense with female protagonists and cats, then they can go search through Wattpad and find exactly what the publisher wants. This is an algorithmic search capability that they use, and I bet some of you techies know more about that than I do. But combine that with the enormous amount of material they have and people who are clearly interested in that, and you have a potentially significant new book publisher. Their logo, I thought it was interesting, is a photograph, probably doctored, of a woman. You see her from the back staring out into water. If you've looked online at book covers, particularly in some of the women's fiction or romance areas, this is a very common meme that you see used as cover art all the time, the woman staring out into a body of water. Apparently that really speaks to some people. I mean, there's only one reason something gets used over and over as book covers, and that's because it works. And now they're using it as the logo for Wattpad Books, which suggests that there might be a young female focus for this publishing line. Yet another alternative for writers outside of the traditional New York publishing industry. But there's a little bit going on in traditional publishing too, because the well-known mystery publisher and bookseller, Mysterious Books' Otto Pendler and Pegasus Books, are creating a new publishing line called Scarlet. Now, just to be upfront, I know Otto Pendler. I've worked with him in the past. I think he's a great guy, so I am hardly impartial here. Nonetheless, a new line from Pendler, a mystery line, is a significant development. The company says they're going to focus on psychological suspense, quote, with primarily female readers in mind, end quote. Again, we see the emphasis on female readers and presumably in large part female writers. There's a good reason for that. Something like 2/3, maybe even more, of all mystery thriller type books are bought by females, usually about 35 to 60. If you thought all those macho thrillers were primarily being read by guys, you're probably wrong. Anyway, Scarlet says they're going to publish 6 to 8 novels in their first year, starting in 2020, and they've already got a distribution deal with Norton, so how great is that? Their buying director, Louisa Smith, has described the line like this. She says, quote, suspenseful stories, unique perspectives, and quality writing all play important roles in my favorite books, and we hope to find these elements in every Scarlet title, end quote. So, even though there's a lot going on in the world of non-traditional publishing, there's some life in traditional publishing as well. These may not be quite big five publishers, but any house from Otto Pendler and distributed by Norton is going to be visible in bookstores. So here's another great opportunity for writers. The last news story pertains to Amazon. They posted their fourth quarter results, the quarter that ended December 31st, and here's the news. Sales are up. Net sales rose 19.7% to $72.4 billion. Their growth rate is down somewhat, and as a result of that, their stock fell about 4% after these results were announced, although I noticed it largely corrected itself the next day. It's hard to imagine anyone seriously complaining about an extra $72 billion. Obviously, Amazon is still going strong all across the board. Here's the part I particularly wanted to highlight for you. This was buried in their press release and is pretty much the only part of this release that pertains to books. The release says, quote, in 2018, authors earned more than $260 million from the Kindle Direct Publishing Select Global Fund, totaling more than $840 million since the launch of Kindle Unlimited. Hundreds of thousands of authors have self-published millions of books through KDP since launching the service in 2007. Here's the good part. Additionally, thousands of independent authors earned more than $50,000, with more than 1,000 surpassing 100,000 in royalties in 2018 through KDP. That's the first update on those figures we've had for 2018. They said something similar for 2017, and it seems that that continued into the last year. More than 1,000 authors making more than $100,000 in royalties, which most people would consider a living wage. And beyond that, thousands, unspecified thousands, earned more than $50,000, which is decent in and of itself. So, is it possible to make money as an independent or self-publisher? Clearly so. Does it happen every time or even close? No, clearly not. But is it possible? If you do a good job, write well, market enthusiastically? Absolutely. Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, has been in the news a lot lately for problems with National Enquirer and personal life, and I'm not going to get into that. I think it's unfortunate. Nobody likes to see gossip mongers invading people's personal lives. Although I have to say that, you know, if the worst occurs and that ever happens to you as it did with Mr. Bezos, like him, try to have an extra $2 or $3 billion in the bank. I can't help but think that makes it better. In this debut installment of the Writing Tips segment, I wanted to talk a little bit about writing style, specifically the kind of direct and immediate style that leads to success, particularly in popular fiction and nonfiction. As some of you already know, I've written a book on the subject, Sizzling Style, which is available in print, ebook, and audiobook read by yours truly. But there's a new book on the market that covers similar territory. This is called Dreyer's English, an utterly correct guide to clarity and style, written by Benjamin Dreyer, who has been a proofreader and copy editor at St. Martin's and many other traditional New York publishers for many, many years. And this is sort of his version of the style guide. There have been style guides like this in the past, and too often there are, you know, people obsessing about grammar or commas and really not containing a lot of practical takeaway for writers like us, for red sneaker writers. But this book's a little different. I like this one. I like in particular his occasional tongue-in-cheek attitude and is trying to move away from pomposity and unnecessary stuffiness. For instance, he doesn't like people who say reside. You mean live, right? He says, you mean live. And I feel the same way. Lawyers are the worst at using a 10-letter word where a 3- or 4-letter word will do. But often when I'm editing people's fiction, I do the same thing. Look, this character whose dialogue you're writing is a regular person. Have them sound like a regular person, couldn't you? There are many things that he flags in his book that are completely echoing things I said in Sizzling Style. For instance, he advises people to avoid suddenly as a way of ramping up the excitement. He urges people to avoid began to. I would also add started to. He tells people to, quote, go light on exclamation points in dialogue. No, even lighter than that. Are you down to none yet? Good, end quote. I was more generous in Sizzling Style. I said you could have one per book, remember? He also urges people to avoid fancy synonyms for said, S-I-S-A-I-D, said. You know, most of the time, said is okay. People don't notice the repetition, and it's better than many highfalutin substitutes. Occasionally, said, replied, asked, maybe even a shouted once or twice, but don't be afraid to use said repetitively. It's probably better than the substitute. If you think you've said it too many times, maybe you should be